So some of you have already been talking, so you've already been introducing yourselves to Laura. But I'm introducing Laura Van Zoest, who is a professor of mathematics education, interestingly in a math department, not an education department, at Western Michigan University. She's been on sabbatical here for 5 months, or this is now working for 5 months. She's been here since January. With her family, with her son enrolled in school, which she can talk about, that seems to be working well. Her research focuses on the practice of, on the process of becoming an effective mathematics teacher and how resources such as university coursework, professional development, and curriculum materials can facilitate that process. So you can see her current work is on MOST, which stands for Mathematical Opportunities in Student Thinking. And her main project during her sabbatical year was to work on the book that she's going to talk about, I'm sure. And one of her main goals in her on the sabbatical was to share her ideas with people and get lots of feedback. So I know that one of the things she really wants today is to get lots of feedback from all of us. So with that, I will turn it over to you.
Okay. Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here today, and it has been a pleasure to be here since January, especially in January since I'm from Michigan. And it's been great to be here on my sabbatical for a lot of reasons, but probably the most important one is how open people are to sharing ideas. And I've had conversations with several people in this room and how others plan, and really have appreciated that openness and willingness to engage in some great conversations. So, my colleagues, Sherry Staccaro at Michigan Tech, Keith Latham and Blake Peterson at Brigham Young University, and myself started doing this work together about 10 years ago. We discovered that in our independent observations of the graduates of our secondary teacher preparation programs, as we watched them teaching their mathematics in their classrooms, that we had been quite successful at preparing them to elicit student thinking. Yay, that was a good thing. That was the good news. The bad news was that they didn't seem to be recognizing teachable moments. So in our very different geographical regions, we'd be observing teachers, and we'd be sitting on the edge of our chair because a student had just made this really powerful mathematics comment, and we couldn't wait to see what would happen. And then we would sink back because the moment would just pass by. So our desire to do a better job at preparing our students to act on this, the student thinking that they were able to elicit, is what sort of started our quest to make sense of teachable moments, to really unpack them, and to figure out what it takes to recognize them. So this is really interesting. Can't really see, I have to point, because the red doesn't show up on my slide for some reason. So, we've been doing this work with a number of graduate students, postdocs, and teacher researchers, and they are all, you can find all of their names on the Building on MOST website up there. But I'm very pleased to acknowledge Lindsay Merrill, who's in the room here with us, because she now lives in Palo Alto and teaches at the local community college. But she was our very first MOST research assistant we started this project. So all the credit goes to the great foundation she had with us.
Laura, if it doesn't derail your presentation, I'd love to know how this cluster of people became this collaborative research group. But if that derails you, we can just wait to the end.
You want me to tell you a story? I like that. So what happened is Sherry was my doctoral student about a long, long, long time ago. Longer than 10 years. 15 years, I guess. And she and I were doing some work after she graduated on what we called pivotal teaching moments, which were those unexpected instances that happened in the classroom. So we were at an Association for Mathematics Teacher Educators conference presenting on our work. And Keith and Blake were doing work on, I think they were actually calling it teachable moments, and presenting at the same conference. So we went to their talk, they went to our talk, and we thought, maybe we should work together. And so that's how we ended up doing this work together. And we've been very fortunate. One of our first things that we did was do a test. We did a working group at the Psychology of Math Ed conference to see if these ideas had any legs to them. And then we submitted a proposal to NSF for funding. And it took us a couple tries. We kept working on it, but we were able to get funded back in 2012, and we've been funded since. So it's been a really great collaborative research project in the truest sense of the word. I want to acknowledge the National Science Foundation, because without their support, none of this really could have been possible. So I also want to say the website provides all of the research, a list of all of the research and access to other things related to our work. So I'm not going to talk a lot today about the specific research studies behind what I'm showing. I'm just going to share the ideas. So before we go on, I just have a few quick questions for you. I got a little bit of a feel as people were coming in. But how many people are currently teaching mathematics at any level? How many people have taught mathematics in the past? How many people have been a mathematics student? All right, so you're all qualified to be here. I just want to get a feel for how many of you are in the classroom right now. So just to orient you, our work focuses on whole class interactions. So it's grounded in secondary school, 6th through 12th grade mathematics classrooms, and it focuses specifically on recognizing teachable moments in whole class interactions. So that's kind of important. I'll contrast it to the work of Jen Munson, who some of you might be familiar with. She's a graduate of here, and she also gave a talk in the same series roughly a year ago. Her work is in the same problem space as mine, but she works with looking at small groups and teachers' responses during conferring with students in these small groups. So a different part of the problem space, but we take very similar, I think, theoretical perspectives and approaches. So small groups versus whole class interactions. We follow the whole class interaction approach. So I want you to participate at least a little bit in this talk. So think for a moment about a teachable moment you have experienced. You're all here because teachable moment meant something to you. So either as a teacher, as observing a class, or even as a student, but think about a teachable moment that you've experienced or observed. When you have one, just do the thumb on the chest so I can tell you. If you got nothing, you can think of a hypothetical. Here's the most important question related to this talk. What made it a teachable moment? So think about your teachable moment. What was it that made it a teachable moment? Do something that's really kind of hard. I want you to talk about the second question without going into detail about the teachable moment. And the very nature of teachable moments is that you want to tell people about them. So I realize that I'm asking you to do something that's kind of hard. But let's try it. So what made the teachable moment that you have in mind a teachable moment? Anybody? Something that made it a teachable moment.
So I'm thinking of one time during a member talk. It's also
Okay.
Basically, the student was seeing, it was a pattern, and she was seeing it in a certain way, and I understood what she was saying, but nobody else understood what she was saying, but I didn't step in to try to paraphrase or clarify. I let her just keep trying and trying, and they were getting frustrated, and eventually she, you know, went up there and was like, explained it really clearly, and everybody was just like, oh, you know, that kind of thing. And so I think it was like me just not stepping in, you know, and just letting them kind of work through it.
Just a topic that was pretty dry without some sort of relevance, and the student brought up something that they like, and I think was personally involved in this. And so we were able to kind of chase down that avenue about some of the other things that we related to, and it helped them to put the other topic back to you, you know, build the topic idea. So it was an opportunity and a way for them to relate to the more abstract piece that we were.
things. What made it a teachable moment?
The pattern when I think about a variety of teachable moments is I'm thinking ahead where I want this smaller idea to go in terms of a bigger fabric, and pondering how I'm going to make that happen, how I'm going to make that happen. And the learner hands you that opening on the silver platter so that you know you're not the one connecting the dots. They're connecting the dots, or they're providing the opportunity for the dots to be connected in the public learning space by how they ask a question that goes beyond what you were just doing or begins. Even the example of like applying something that you thought was sort of dry or abstract, and they go, is that like blah, blah, blah? Those places when it opens up.
So I was thinking about a different kind of place where it opens up things, where I knew that there was a concept that I was trying to get across in my class, and I knew people didn't really get it because it's a hard one to get. This is about what's a conceptual framework when you're doing research, and I kept trying to make the point that if you ask 5 teacher people, you'll get 10 answers. And I said something, and one of the students said, but another professor said, and I could stop them and say, okay, this is a really good example of the fact that people have different ideas about really abstract, complex concepts. So it allowed me to come back to something that I knew that they didn't really have processed fully. Mm-hmm. Probably still don't, but they're closer.
We've had pretty good representation from
So like when a student brings up like a misconception about something during a lesson, I think it's a teachable moment because you can go kind of address where they're at and where they're thinking is at, and then have maybe other students build like agree or disagree, and then have them construct viable arguments and critique each other. And that's like where they can teach each other or come to grasp like what's how and build knowledge together.
Any other things to add? I think I'm good, but I want to give everybody who has a chance, who has something they want to share, the chance to do it. So, going once? Okay. So, this is really helpful. You can see there's some, you can probably recognize some threads across what was said and also some differences. So, I want you all to hang on to your teachable moment because if all goes well, we'll come back to them at the end. So, keep them in your mind. And you know, we're teacher educators, my colleagues and I, but we're also researchers. So when we started our quest to make sense of teachable moments, we went to the literature to see what had already been done. And at the time that we started, there were no studies on teachable moments, but we did find descriptions of teachable moments, or at least things that sounded like them to us. So out of some of the literature, I just have selected some things to give you a feel for what we found. Critical moments in the classroom when students created a moment of choice or opportunity. Sounds a little familiar. Novel student ideas that prompt teachers to reflect on and rethink their instruction. Potentially powerful learning opportunities. Significant mathematical instances. Students' comment provides the fodder for a content-related conversation. Crucial mathematical hinge moments.
In the bottom and the two up. Mm-hmm. Who is offering the significant mathematical instance of the crucial mathematical hinge?
The students. Oh. Yeah, even though it's not so, I'm confident that it's the students. Yeah. And in fact, when we looked, and these are clips, right? So when we looked across these references and several others that wouldn't fit on the screen, we noticed a few things. One of them, students consistently came up. Mathematics, the content area. Pedagogy, relating to communicating or teaching, Kilda's example. And so we took those things, students, mathematics, and pedagogy, and came up with 3 characteristics that we felt were part of these teachable moments. So student mathematical thinking, this idea that it comes from students, not the teacher, and that it's about mathematics. And not just any mathematics, but mathematics that's worth spending scarce instructional time on. I'm pretty sure that if I asked you, there's nobody who would say, I don't know what to do in my class. I don't have enough stuff to cover. You know, there's a limited amount of time. And it's stuff that's significant. And it's opportune, that also came up, opportune in the sense that something's lost if it isn't acted on in the moment. So the student contributions that exhibit all of these characteristics that fall in the intersection are this special kind of teachable moment that we call most. So what's a most? Hilda already gave it away. You probably don't remember. A most is a mathematically, actually you gave the short name, a mathematically significant pedagogical opportunity to build on student thinking. Okay. Try saying that fast 10 times. So in the effort to communicate more effectively, we did come up with a shorter name, Mathematical Opportunities in Student Thinking. So that's what a most is. And the short name doesn't convey quite as much information, but it's a lot easier to remember. So there's another thing that came up in the literature that's really important to most and it's worth emphasizing. And that's that these mathematical opportunities that we're talking about are instances of student thinking. They're fairly short. It's not a long, drawn-out thing. It's a fairly quick thing. And they're most productive to pursue in the moment. And in fact, if you don't pursue them in the moment, as I mentioned, they can become missed opportunities. So these most are in-the-moment opportunities. So we are in California, right? So metaphorically speaking, most are pedagogical waves that can be caught in. So specifically, we see most as these pedagogical waves that can engage students in a rich conversation that leads to an aha moment about an important mathematical idea. And then if a most is not acted on in the moment in which it occurs, the opportunity is lost or at least significantly diminished. Okay, I'm going a little bit out on a limb here because I'm not a surfer, but from watching, it looks to me that it's much like a surfer would miss the opportunity to ride a wave if they don't catch it at just the right moment. You may also have experienced this in the moment aspect when a teachable moment happens in one class and you get so excited about it that you try to recreate it in another class and it just doesn't work. Yeah, so that's this in the moment nature of it. And I just, one more way to emphasize that is to use another body of work that I know at least some of you are familiar with, probably all of you, and that's 5 practices for orchestrating productive discussions. So Smith and Stein's work centers on using student thinking that emerges from working on rich mathematical tasks, and the 5 practices support, that's interesting, it's much more colorful. So the 5 practices support how you can use the work that students do on those rich tasks to have meaningful discussions that help them better understand math. So our work complements, and I love the fact that you noticed that just from my description, but it complements Smith and Stein's work in at least 2 ways. One of them, you know, their work, as I said, focuses on rich mathematical tasks. Ours is broader in that it's any kind of student contribution. So we're looking across them all. You know, most can occur even in the midst of a lecture. And often that's when the teacher is describing a procedure, or demonstrating a procedure, and a student persists in trying to make sense of it. So the other way in which we fit with their work is in the midst of doing the 5 practices, during the whole class discussion about the sequencing and connecting, more student contributions emerge in the moment. And that's what we're about. So the most are about that. So most are these in-the-moment opportunities, but that begs the question of opportunities for what? So I have an answer. So it's a long answer. So most are opportunities for the teacher to make student thinking the object of consideration by the class in order to engage the class in making sense of that thinking to better understand an important lesson. That's really a definition for what we call the teaching practice of building. And And we feel that this teaching practice of building, this thing that we've described here, is the most productive response to most. So if you have a most, this is what you want to do. And to just better, to help you better understand why we think that, I want to share what we call our principles underlying productive use of student mathematical thinking. And we say that these are drawn from NCTM's principles to action because that pulled all these ideas together. But really, they're sort of in the ethos of math education. Lots of people believe these things and follow them. But this is our, our things that really provide the lens through which we look at student thinking. There's four. So the mathematics principle really establishes the use of student thinking requires foregrounding the student thinking and backgrounding the teacher's mathematics. So it's the mathematics of the student is at the front and the mathematics of the teacher is sort of working behind the scenes. The legitimacy principle emphasizes the importance of positioning students as legitimate mathematical thinkers who are able to engage with mathematical ideas in a deep and meaningful way. We're actually toying around with the fact that this might not be one of the four principles, it might be the overarching principle. The sense-making principle makes it clear that students are to be engaged in making sense of mathematical ideas rather than simply receiving information or practicing procedures. They need to be engaged in making sense. The collaboration principle addresses the social nature of learning by highlighting the importance of students working together rather than in isolation as they engage in collaboratively making sense, in our case, sense of the mathematical ideas in the student thinking. Oops, I just want to say one more thing. So as I said before, we see the teaching practice of building as the best response to most, and the reason for that is because it simultaneously embodies all four of these principles. There are lots of other teaching practices which also embody different combinations of these, and there's probably some that do all four, but when you have a most on the table, building seems to be the best answer to these. So there's a lot packed in this definition, so just bear with me as I highlight a few things. So the teacher, it's important to note that we're talking about the teaching practice of building. So that's not to say that building can't be done by students on the thinking of other students. In fact, we think it can, and we think that engaging in the teaching practice of building actually supports that. And there's a really nice article that Miriam Sharon wrote with some colleagues back in 2000 in the mathematics teaching in the middle school that was titled Students Building on One Another's Mathematical Ideas. And so this is not that. That's important, but we're talking about the teaching practice. To illustrate that, consider this. So the student is making a factual statement, but that statement surfaces issues related to the concept of variable. So the student is clearly not okay with variables varying. So just for another chance for audience participation, what are some possible unproductive teacher responses that could occur to this student contribution? Anybody? What might be? Not that any of you would ever do this. Lindsay?
Well, today it's three.
Yep. Okay. Not very productive. Okay. Other unproductive responses.
Well, it is a variable, so that means it varies.
Okay. Oh, one more.
You don't understand what X is. Okay.
Those are clearly not going to help the student resolve his dilemma. So now I'm going to give you two ways that fall a little bit more on the productive end of how teachers could respond. So here's one of them. Hopefully you can see it better. That's because a letter can be used to represent an unknown quantity in a given equation, and the same letter can represent different quantities in different equations. So this is a mathematically sound answer to the question that the student asked. So there's nothing wrong with it, right? Well, maybe. Okay. Here's a contrasting response. There's nothing mathematical. You're right, in yesterday's equation, x was equal to 2, and in this equation, x is equal to 3. How can that be? Does anybody have an idea? So in this response, the student thinking is foregrounded, which adheres to the mathematics principle for productive use of student thinking. And although we don't know how it's going to play out, the teacher has really set the stage for the other three principles of legitimacy, sense making, and collaboration. So you can guess which one I like. So when building on most, the student thinking itself is the object of consideration. That's what we want students to be thinking about, like the second response in the comment. Contrast this with student thinking that's used as, say, an opportunity to correct a common misconception, or perhaps an opportunity to find out more about the student's thinking, or a mini review lesson, which was kind of like the first response. All of those things are really valid teacher moves. They have their place. But if there's a most on the table, responding in one of those ways would lead to a missed opportunity. So that's probably the message that I want to give. And then just to highlight, it's the class that's doing the heavy mathematical lifting, not the teacher. Even though the teacher got it going, the thinking is done by the class, and it's also not done by the student who made the contribution, or at least not only done by the student who made the contribution. We see a lot of tendency to go back to the student, teacher one-on-one conversation, so that would not count as building. And then this last part is pretty important. It's the purpose, or sort of our end goal, to understand the importance. So these in-the-moment opportunities to build on student thinking are present in all of our classrooms, no matter what kind of classroom we have, and in the classrooms of the teachers with whom we work. There's more in some classrooms than others. There is a correlation between the amount of student thinking that's elicited in a classroom and the number of most. It's pretty strong, actually. So what we've been trying to figure out is how to identify and better understand these. So the million-dollar question, how can we determine if a student contribution is a most, other than having lots of experience and knowledge and all those things? How could we speed up the process? So we worked to operationalize our ideas about teachable moments by analyzing all the student contributions that occurred in videotaped classroom mathematics lessons. It took us about 2 years to do that, because there's quite a lot, and it's really time-consuming to look at them. But that allowed us to use this iterative process of generating theory, testing it out with practice, refining the theory, and testing it out again. We also supplemented that work with interviews with teachers, teacher development experiments, and teacher research enactments. And I'm hoping somebody will ask me about the last one later, because that's what we're currently doing. So come back to that later, I hope. Okay, so this is the diagram again. But we found that it was really important to be systematic in how we looked at these. And so we started with student mathematical thinking, because that really seemed like the foundation. And then we went through mathematically significant, because that seemed primary to what we were doing, and then went to pedagogical opportunity. And approaching the process in this way, both for our research, it just made sense to do the things we cared about most first. Because a pedagogical opportunity that didn't have anything to do with mathematics wasn't really going to help us. But we've also found that it's helpful when working with teachers, because the pedagogical opportunity sometimes jumps out first, and then you have to back up, and it's important to think about, okay, what's the math of it? So we started with the three characteristics, but then in the process of doing our analysis of the videotapes, we were able to kick it up a notch and look at the level of criteria for each of these characteristics. And in a very satisfying way, we ended up with 2 for each of them. So that's mathematics thing, I think. I don't expect you to read this right now. We're going to zoom in on it, but I wanted to give you a feel for this most analytic framework. So this is a tool for learning how to identify, well, for researching, but also for learning how to identify these particularly high-leverage teachable moments. So we've got the three characteristics and the 2 criteria for each. one thing that's important to notice is that it's like a flow chart, and if you have a yes, you keep going, but as soon as you get a no, it kicks it out. Because to be a most, it has to have all of these things. So as soon as you know it doesn't have one, you're done. You don't have to do any more thinking about it. So we don't have time to actually prepare you to use this or dig into it that deeply, but I want to just give you a sense for it and why these things are important to us. So think of what you're about to hear as sort of the Cliff Notes version. The framework itself both does two things. It answers this question of whether a student contribution is a most, but if it's not a most, it also gives us some useful information that supports ways that we can be productive in our responses, even if it's not a most. And I'll try to give you a little bit of that too. So I'm going to go through the process with a particular student contribution, and I picked one that had very little context that was needed. It's in a beginning algebra class. Students have been given several minutes to work on the following task. Which is larger, x or x plus x? Explain your reason. So after the students had a little bit of time to work on that, the teacher asks, who can tell me which they think is larger? And after just a little pause, she called on Chris. And Chris responded, I think x plus x is bigger because it's 2x, and that's bigger than x. So this is a student contribution, and it's the one we're going to keep looking at. And you might have ideas about what Chris said. Have a chance to think about it. So in the most analytic framework, the first characteristic was student mathematical thinking. It's got two aspects, the student mathematics and the mathematical. So the first one, can the student mathematics be articulated? Okay, why is that important? To decide whether we want to engage the students in thinking about a student contribution, we have to know exactly what math is in there. What do we have to work with? And so this gives us a chance to figure out if there is math in there, and if so, what it is. So in this case, we didn't have to do a lot of work because the students was pretty complete, but you might notice that what we often do have to do is bring in the question, like we did here, and also replace the referent with what it's referring to. Conversational, or, you know, ways in which we talk about math mean that we don't put the question in our answer, and we don't do those kinds of things. So that's an example of that. Basically, we're just trying to figure out what do we need to be clear about and what would the students need to be clear about if they were going to engage in having a conversation about this particular instance. I just want to say one thing about when you don't have student mathematics or why you might not have student mathematics. Anybody have ideas about why you wouldn't have student mathematics and a student contribution? I mean, there's the obvious one about it has nothing to do with math, but if it looks like it might be mathematical, any ideas about why you wouldn't be able to articulate the math?
Well, I had a question about just the framing of can the student mathematics be articulated versus, like, can a teacher re-articulate the student's mathematics? And sort of just thinking about, like, an interpretive and noticing framework of perhaps I can't, as your teacher, yet articulate the mathematics that you are attempting to communicate, which perhaps speaks to us needing to do something different that we pursue the most, right? If it's not me, if it's not re-articulated a goal by me yet as the teacher, how can I pursue the rest of this process?
I love the way you just answered your own question. I think that's what happened, because that's exactly what I would have said. The reason we say, can the student mathematics be articulated, you know, we could say by the teacher at this point in time, but the key idea is that if the teacher's going to turn it back to the class, it has to be in a way that they can, and there's something clear for them to engage with. So for example, a common thing that we see is the student uses, like, that equation, and maybe they're pointing to the board and there's two or three equations, and we don't know which one that is. That's something that's called, we call it clarifiable ambiguity, because the student knows it's just not clear. And if we didn't clarify it, if we were to just turn it over to the class, half of the class might be thinking it's this equation and the other half might be thinking it's that equation. And you can imagine the Lindsay knows a little bit about this because Lindsay worked on this for a paper when she was at BYU. And we have a whole paper on this idea of clarifiable ambiguity and what that can do for you as a teacher if you recognize it. And what happens if you don't recognize it and turn it back over to the class. So that's an instance where it's not a most, and the fact that you can't articulate it gives you some insight into how you might want to respond. Building is not how you would respond, but there might be you asking a clarifying question. So it isn't enough that the contribution involves student mathematics. If we're going to turn it over to the class to engage with making sense of, there has to be some mathematical point. There has to be something mathematical that they can get out of that. And so the question here is, does the student mathematics have a mathematical point? And just briefly, because this is another whole paper, unfortunately, these things are all turning out to be pretty complicated. When we're talking about a mathematical point, we're talking about a well-specified statement of a mathematical truth. What often happens is we look at it and we think, oh yeah, that's about domain, and we leave it at that level. And what we're finding out is that maybe that's the problem or the reason that we're not getting the benefits out of using student thinking that we had hoped for, because we're not being specific enough about what it is we want to accomplish by discussing the student thinking. So what we're looking for here is this idea of a well-specified statement of a mathematical truth, like in this case, not just the fact that it's about domain, but that what students could get out of engaging with this student contribution is the fact that all possible values within a domain must be considered to determine relative values of vertical expressions. So this student contribution, I think x plus x is bigger because it's 2x and that's bigger than x, is only partly true. It's true if they're thinking about positive numbers for the domain, but not the other. So that's this idea, and we want it to be closely related to the SM. There might be a lot of things that you could get from talking about the student math. We want the one that we think is the closest, and that's part of honoring the student thinking, staying really close to it. So we have now found out that this particular contribution did have student math that could be articulated. It did have a math point, so therefore it embodied the student math thinking characteristic, and we're on our way to the next one. So we have the yes, we can keep on going. So when an instance meets the criteria for student mathematic thinking, we can take that MP that we've identified and use that to go on to mathematically significant. Yeah?
So maybe we'll talk about this at a different point, but I'm wondering about where does sort of like the, I don't know how to call it, like the surprise factor come in. Like in that problem, you were going to expect that as a student response, right? And it seems easier to plan for that and think about it versus when it comes from out of nowhere and you don't know what they're talking about, it takes some time to, you know what I mean? So
right.
It seems like it'd be harder to recognize in the moment those characteristics for something that came out of nowhere and you think about it.
Yes. Yes, that is true. But it's kind of like when you're working with students, the five practices, and you're anticipating how students might respond to a task. You probably won't think about all of them, but if you can think about a lot of them, it makes it a lot easier to put your leftover mental energy into thinking about the ones you can't. So it is true. When we did a study, we found out that, I'm getting a little bit ahead of myself, but we found out that roughly 60% of the most that emerged in the classrooms we studied occurred at the lesson level. So about 2/3 are gonna be ones that you probably could anticipate. And then the other ones, maybe not so much. So that's kind of an interesting point about that. So we use the MP to look at mathematical significance. And there's two parts that we think are pretty important: the mathematically appropriate part and mathematically central. So here we're trying to figure out, is this mathematically worth spending class time on? So this is looking at it from the mathematics So mathematically appropriate. Is the mathematical point accessible to students with this level of mathematical experience, but not likely to have already been mastered? Not too hard, not too easy. And you can imagine that either one of those possibilities are going to be unproductive use of classroom time. If they can't engage with it, you don't want to turn it over to them and have them try to make sense of it if they don't have the background to do that. That's just spinning wheels and getting frustrated. On the other hand, if they've already achieved some level of fluency, the level of fluency that they're expected to learn, you're also wasting time because there's nothing more for them to learn. So it's that sweet spot.
Mm-hmm. So how do you deal with that, knowing that the answer is going to be different across the range of mathematical understanding in the class?
Yeah, so all of this work is looking at it at the whole class level. And so in the same way that you deal with it, the same way a teacher always has to deal with it. You know, you've got your class full of people, and you're looking at the class as a whole and making decisions about the class as a whole.
Okay. So I'll just say to that, like, one, like a moment like this might go through this framework a little bit differently in one classroom than another class, like depending on where the students are at.
Yeah, that's
what your class has learned so far, where it is in your lesson.
Yeah, that's a really good point. There are no universal hosts.
Mm-hmm.
There might be some things that come pretty close.
Yeah.
You know, when we look at Mathematica Central, we can talk about that. But yeah, it's very relative, which makes this hard. I can't give you a laundry list of hosts. I wish I could. That would make it all much, much easier. So our example contribution took place in a beginning algebra class. Thus, they are likely to have the background to engage with this student mathematics to get at the mathematical point that we have up here. They have what it takes to engage with it. On the other hand, this is a challenging thing for students for a really long time. So it's also unlikely that beginning algebra students have mastered it, at least at the class level. So that means that it would meet the mathematically appropriate criteria. And I just want to say, you might think that pursuing mathematically appropriate student contributions would come naturally to teachers. But we found that's not true, even in our own practice. Sometimes you get wrapped up in the fact that it's cool student thinking, and you don't necessarily step back and think about, is this going to help them learn math or not? So the MP also has to be related to be mathematically central, and that's related to the learning goals for students in the classroom. So mathematically appropriate is about their developmental ability, their mathematical development ability to engage with it. Mathematically central is about, is it an important goal for them? Worth spending that scarce instructional time? So imagine a continuum that includes all the goals for students learning. For the students in this class, all of those goals. The positioning on the goal is relative to any given lesson. In our case, the lesson that the student contribution occurred in. So you've got the goals of the lesson, goals of other lessons in the unit, other units in the course, and then goals beyond the course. Now think about what it takes for a goal along this continuum to be central enough to student learning to be able to take up class time. So if it's in the goals of the lesson, okay, that's what you're supposed to be doing. So it's sort of central by default. It's on the low end of the centrality threshold. But the further you move away from the lesson, the more important the idea has to be to warrant pushing away what you were going to do and spending time on it. So to go back to Lindsay's question, there are some things, goals beyond the course, that you might think, okay, that is such an important mathematical idea that if it comes up in pretty much any class, I might want to take the time to do that. But for the most part, you know, it's a pretty high threshold when you get up beyond the course. So in our example of Chris's contribution, the MP was related to the goal of the task. So we can assume it's in the lesson goal, and therefore it's central pretty much by default. For contrast, think back to the comic. So the MP for this would be related to understanding the meaning of variable. This is in a lesson, we can assume it's a comic, but we can assume that this is a lesson on solving simple linear equations. So the meaning of variable is probably not going to go for that lesson. probably not even a goal for that unit. It's possible, but probably not. More likely, it's going to fall in goals for other units in the course. So the centrality threshold out there is pretty high. But meaning a variable is pretty core to algebra. So we would argue that that also meets the centrality. So both of those instances, both Chris's contribution and the comic, meet that. Centrality, they are mathematically central, but for very different reasons. So we can see that we met the criteria for our sample instance for mathematically appropriate and mathematically central, so it is mathematically significant. And in the way that mathematically significant was about whether it's a good use of class time from a mathematical perspective, now we're going to look at pedagogical opportunities and whether the instance of student thinking is pedagogically appropriate. So there's two things with pedagogical opportunity, opening and timing. So opening, does the expression of the student mathematics create an intellectual need that, if met, will contribute to understanding the mathematical point? So when we talk about intellectual need, we're drawing on some work by Harrell in 2013. He introduced this idea of intellectual need, that students have an intellectual need to make sense of something. And in our case, it's making sense of student mathematics. So there's some kind of intellectual need. They might want to interact with the contribution. I'm using some of Harrell's examples here, because they feel the need for certainty, or the need for causality, or for structure related to the mathematics. So there's something compelling, and that came out in some of your examples too, there's something compelling that the students want to engage with. So in our case, all of the students in the class had engaged with that problem. So they had ideas. Chris's was one idea, and we can, it might not be the most exciting thing in the world to them, but there's some intellectual need for them to make sense of it because they've got some skin in the game. Have an answer, they want to know if their answer, if Chris's is right, either because it is the same as theirs or it isn't. So we would argue that there is an intellectual need for the class to make sense of Chris's claim. So pedagogical openings related to the intellectual need that the students might feel. Pedagogical timing is about the teacher and the plans for their learning activities. So as the instructional leader of our class, we have a responsibility to make good choices about how we use our time. And so we need to decide, is this the right time to engage with the student contribution? And the way we can make that is by thinking, is having a conversation about this contribution going to move them forward in their goals, or is it going to hinder them in some way? For example, if the contribution came out in this case before the other students had had a chance to think about it themselves, then the timing would not be right because it could interfere with their ability to think about the mathematics. So in our instance, they had that time, and we could say that the timing is pretty much perfect because the contribution that Chris made will move them forward in understanding exactly what you want them to understand. It's not going to interfere. Okay, so that was a lot. Glad you were able to hang with me. We've now seen that Chris's contribution satisfies the pedagogical opening and pedagogical timing criteria, so it's a pedagogical opportunity, and we have a most. And you knew it had to be a most, right? Because I needed to show you the whole thing. But hopefully it's given you a little bit of a sense of what kinds of things make something a most and not a most. So, just to go back with the characteristics we started with, and then this is our operationalization of them. And I promised you at the end of the talk, which I'm now at, that I would go back to this question, to your most, and this is the question. So the teachable moment that you had in mind, now that you know what you know about most, is it a most? Or is it a different kind? that's where I'm going to go next. But I really, I'm curious about how many people think that their teachable moment was the most. Maybe? Okay.
I think the one we talked about the other morning.
That one's pretty complicated.
Yeah.
I don't know if I want to talk about that one.
Mine was on fractions,
uh-huh.
like dividing fractions,
uh-huh.
and kind of like, it was something, I'm making up the exact numbers that I don't remember, but it was like something like 6 divided by 1/3, and why isn't that 2 versus like, and how exactly the person was trying to remember how the algorithm worked, but he didn't understand the rationale behind like flipping the stuff, the reciprocal, and things like that.
So you had student mathematical thinking, for sure.
Yeah.
And could you articulate the mathematical point that you think you could get out of that? Putting you on the spot, because this is kind of a hard thing to do. But do you, just answer, do you think you could? Would it be possible to pin it down to what it is you think students could learn from engaging with that?
They could learn, like, why you multiply by reciprocal specifically, and kind of how fractions work, like how, like if you have 6 holes, you can divide the holes into 1/3 parts, and then they could count and see how many fractional parts there are in 6 holes.
So that what we found, and I think Lindsay can attest to this, although much of the work came after, we got better at it as we went along. Our expectations got higher and higher. But what I would encourage you to do is you have the kernel of a mathematical point to try to figure out what exactly it is that the students would learn from doing that. You have all the pieces, and the challenge is to actually then put it down, write it in a sentence. And they're like, what is it that they really learn? And we found that to be really hard work, but really a great learning opportunity for us as researchers and for all the students who have worked with us in particular too.
I think that work is something that you can do ahead of time in all of this, like in preparation to deal with the most that may come out of your classroom. If you took the time to like maybe anticipate what mathematical points are at the core of your lesson or something like that, then when students' comments come up, you can, when the student mathematics comes up, you can kind of like have a list in your head, like comparing it, you know what I mean? Like for example, you said this has to do with domain, right? But just throwing the domain out there is not a mathematical point. You have to articulate, like, you have to consider all x in the domain, you know, whatever the mathematical point is you can make with. And that's work you can do ahead of time. A lot of this is in the moment. But
it seems like you can also anticipate, like, in that lesson, dividing by fractions is such, it's one of those things that you know kids are going to have misconceptions about. Because it comes up over and over and over. So to think through in advance, what point do you want to make sure students understand about division of fractions? Then that seems like, and if you can articulate that in advance, then you've got at least the second box.
Right. And and that is the hard one. The mathematically significant is probably, I think the other two are much, much easier. That's the hard one, but it's also what provides a foundation for the other two.
I just, and you might not be at this point yet, but I just wondered in your research whether or not you had now started applying this to your teacher education program and shared this concept of most with teachers and then seeing whether or not they've been able to take it up and respond more productively in their class and identify more effectively most.
Yes. And the first answer was when I first did it, I tried to come at it from a more of the, oh, let me tell you what a most is. Let's learn about most and then go do it. That did not work because they're not at the point of even, they're just not there yet. So what I've been doing in my pre-service teacher classes now is more infusing these ideas and we talk about them indirectly. And that's starting to help. We use a lot of the routines for reasoning work, which you might be familiar with, because that provides a nice framework for using student thinking, and it's a very contained type of a situation. And in the context of that, yes, they are improving. So I don't have research on it, but intuitively,
just curious, it's better.
We've got to get better at figuring, you know, that's what motivated this, is how do you help people do it? We're making good progress. I told you that I would hope that somebody asked, I'm going to bring it in. You know, what we're working on right now is responding to most. And that is, once we figure that completely out, or at least more out than we have right now, then I think I'll have a better idea of how to help entry service teachers too. So that was the first part. What about mathematically? Obviously that is mathematically significant, because if you're working in that, I think we could agree with that pretty quickly. And then pedagogic opportunity, there was something there for the students to engage with. And I'm assuming that the timing was right based on your plans for the students too. So, yeah, these things all seem to, you know, once you get used to it, although the articulating the student math and the mathematical point is challenging, the loose idea in your head, just having these things to think about, oh yeah, here's an opportunity. You, Lindsay's nodding, because all of us who've worked on the project, including undergrads and grad students and professors, have all felt that this has really impacted our teaching, because we think differently about which student thinking we're going to pursue and not pursue. And that has made quite a difference. So the rest of the time, I want to open it up to discussion. Here's some questions to get you started. What are you confused by? What are you wondering about? And what would you like to know more about? So this is my favorite part, because we get more feedback from you guys. Yes?
So I actually just wanted to share that when I thought of an example, I didn't think of mathematics.
You did not?
I did not, because we had a training at our home office today where we trained principals. And I had a moment where I had to step in and simplify directions, because we were introducing learning principles. And I was wondering if that was the right thing to do. And I kind of used the most framework.
Thank you.
Yeah. And I felt that, you know, I was analyzing that, and I settled on, it was significant, but it was appropriate for me to step in because the level of mathematical experience was not there. The level of learning principle experience was not there. And they had not mastered it already. That was the first time. They're not used to the language. So I felt I had to go in and teach that to progress, right? So I kind of used it in a different situation. Mm-hmm. But this helped me figure out if I did the right thing in that moment for the training.
So when we first started doing this, we were playing around with, okay, is this going to be portable? Is this beyond math? You know, the five practices work for science and different things. And we think that the structure and the types of things that you think about, and also, you know, you mentioned the graduate class, right? Pedagogical. So are there posts? Are there pedagogical opportunities in student thinking? Something like that. So what's going to be different is it's not math. It's something else. And it's not mathematically significant. It's significant in a different way. But we think that the answer is yes. We just happen to live in a math room. Hilda mentioned, I'm in a math department. Things other than that, you know. So yeah, I suspect that it might be portable.
It seems like it would be easier to think about how it's portable to another content area than to another domain like learning. Mm-hmm. Less would have to shift, maybe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Although even in the other domain, there's still content. It's just not. Mm-hmm. Content.
In some ways, the content is pedagogy, so then
that
would really...
That would be messy. But it's still a pedagogical opportunity for the thing you're teaching.
Yeah. So you could take the framework title. I haven't thought enough about the boxes in the boxes, but instead of student mathematical thinking, it said student thinking. And the next one said, what, conceptually significant or domain significant.
Domains. Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I think pedagogical opportunities would stay the same. Mm-hmm. I feel like there's a lot of things one teaches, not necessarily skill development, but things that are conceptual in nature and developed from relationships between
minor ideas, major ideas, meaning.
Mm-hmm. It would still apply to.
Because I feel like a fundamental question of what you're proposing is, when a kid says X, or when a learner says X, do I take it up? Do we use
right.
class time?
Right.
Because
right. right.
class time is
yeah.
a precious resource.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Okay. The first box could even just say, can the learner's question be articulated?
Yeah.
Or whatever
right.
we
right.
articulate. You know?
Right.
And if it's, or
yes.
And if the answer is yes, then you move on.
If it's no, you say see you later.
Yes. Yes. See me after class.
I have a question about where you see the sort of like hot spots for like within this for teacher learning.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm thinking in particular about the point that you made, which is that like, and I teach a elementary math methods course for free service teachers. So putting all of this together with like the five practices, we do a lot of work around planning lessons that start by identifying like what's the big idea here, right? So like, what is the mathematical point or points of my lesson today, and how does it connect to the standard or the other sort of connecting big ideas? And like that's really hard work, right? But
yes.
when we have that and some sort of task or based lesson, then the thinking around anticipating is a really big part of what we do as well, right? So given the big idea, given the task at hand that we've chosen or designed, anticipating like what's going to come up and how do we want to prepare ourselves mm-hmm. to respond. So I guess I'm wondering, like, what does it mean to prepare for the or to be prepared for the moments you didn't prepare for? Right? Like what are the intervention points are like the really, what do we focus on in teacher learning that allows us to do more than sort of the five practices orientation that gets us ready to do this when you say like, you just weren't prepared for that one today.
Right.
I wonder if there's an early step in, mm-hmm. when you're a learning teacher to even realize that your teaching decisions can be comprised factors, just knowing, being able to think of that concept and maybe see it in the video.
My improvisation actually can have a framework to it.
Yeah,
that is based
yes.
on
yeah.
some decision making.
And I would expect really cumbersome implementation during the novice years of teaching.
I have an idea about something that would be really easy to practice. Not easy to do always, but easy to practice. Practicing articulating student thinking and understanding what you can and can't actually articulate. Because I think a lot of times teachers think that they are articulating something correctly and they're actually putting a lot of their own words or knowledge into the statement, right? Like filling in pronouns that aren't actually clear based on what the students know. I think that's an easy thing to practice because when you're like a pre-service teacher, everything looks really clean except for like the few examples you see or something, but in real life it's never clean ever. And so that would be something easy to practice that is a nice entry point into the rest of it, you know?
Yeah, this work in some ways is in response to two obstacles that teachers run into when they're trying to use student thinking. One of them is treating all the student thinking alike, like treating it all as having equal value, and this gives you a way to distinguish among the student thinking. And the other one is hearing what you want them to say.
Yes.
So, taking the student thinking and then just, really it's your thinking. And you just solving for that. Yeah.
I have a question. So I've been trying to think more about like the five strands of proficiency, right? And like how to get teachers to think about more than just procedural fluency and conceptual understanding.
Mm-hmm.
And to me, the most nebulous one is productive disposition. But it feels like this framework is directly, because like you were mentioning, the student legitimacy might even be sort of the overall principle.
Right.
So I'm wondering if this is a way to really promote productive, disposition. And
among the students
among
the teachers? Or both?
Well, teachers being able to see value in student contributions. And because I'm also thinking about like, what you're mentioning, I've definitely had this where you have that moment and it's this great learning opportunity and then you try to make it happen in your next class and it's great, right?
Right.
And I'm wondering if it's like, there's something about, it could be the exact same idea, but it's something about the fact that the student produced it, right? So
totally.
if I say, like, if it's the intellectual need piece. Yeah, because let's say they came up with a new way to look at something that I hadn't thought of, like, that's awesome. And now for my next class or tomorrow's class or whatever, I'm going to build this activity around that. And then here's this activity, but now it's coming from the teacher versus the student, and there's a whole different response to it. So I'm just wondering what, there's something about this idea that it's coming from the student and they're seeing, you know, and to me that's why I feel like productive disposition.
Yeah.
I don't know if that makes sense, but.
It does. I mean, we believe very strongly in our work that student thinking is an underutilized resource for instruction, that we just don't use it well enough, and so this is trying to use it well.
Because that's when they're all listening. Like when
they care about it.
And then, you know, they're like really focused in a very different way than when the teacher is like presenting the task or the idea. Yeah.
Right. In fact, you know, when we're looking at student contributions, if it makes it up to mathematically central, but it doesn't have a pedagogical opening, so it stops here, you could build on those, just don't expect anything great to happen. You know? I mean, it's sort of like, it might be you build on it anyway because it's central, it's moving you forward. You just don't have that same opportune moment that you have. So what you're seeing when you try it in another class, it's still central, but it didn't come from a student in that class. There's no buy-in, there's not the intellectual need. So that's something that we found pretty interesting. Where if you take something that fails here, that's not mathematically significant, and you build on that, you are wasting your time. Mm-hmm. And in fact, you might be doing something unproductive. If it doesn't have a mathematical point, you're asking your students to make sense of something mathematically that there is no mathematical sense to.
Yeah.
That's not productive. So those are all ways that I think we can improve how students use it. But just back to that disposition, I think anytime we can help teachers make good decisions about student thinking, it really encourages student thinking to occur more often. You know, if your thinking is being used in a valid way, then you're going to want to do more.
That's why the legitimacy is the
overriding thing. Yeah, that was our breakthrough a couple of weeks ago. We're still kind of stewing. Do we change everything? You know, the further you get into it, the harder that is. I think our time is up. So.
Our time is up. You're welcome to enjoy refreshments.
Wait, before you go, this is pretty important. So as Hilda mentioned, my sabbatical project has been to take all of our research ideas and put them into a book that would be useful for teachers. And so this is that attempt. It's in a draft, and I need feedback. And so you can talk to me if you're interested in reading this and providing feedback. And I can even offer you a $50 Amazon. As a token of my appreciation. So if you are interested in reading it and providing me feedback, the kinds of questions that I want to know is, you know, is this something that's, what parts are helpful, what parts are not helpful, what gets in the way, those kinds of things. Thank you very much.
Thank you.